In this video, we'll import Misumi parts into Fusion 360, assign joints, and do a small amount of scripting. Misumi has been important to my success, allowing me to do more work independently, and I'd like to share that experience. This is Misumi's last full paper catalog. It's 3,600 pages, about 3.5 kilograms. It contains millions of parts, many of which are customizable. A part can be customized using Misumi's website and then downloaded into a CAD package, ensuring that you're always working with an accurate model of that part. For Misumi parts, I prefer to use the Inventor file format if it's available, and otherwise a step file format. And both I import using Autodesk Cloud Service. The rest of the video will explain how and why. Additional videos are planned in this series, so subscribe if you're interested. You see, I was taught how to design using Misumi parts using SolidWorks, and these videos are a chance to return the favor. So let's get started. The most convenient way to insert a Misumi part into Fusion 360 would seem to be the Parts for CAD option. This is available under the Insert menu and is called Insert a Manufacturer Part. This opens a browser page and allows you to scroll through a number of manufacturers. Each of these manufacturers has parts that can be imported directly into Fusion 360. And that makes the Parts for CAD option pretty powerful. A disadvantage of the Parts for CAD option potentially is that you don't have the level of detail that the manufacturer put into their own web pages. For an example part, let's insert a ball screw. Let's use a 12 millimeter diameter, 4 millimeter pitch ball screw. For this ball screw part, these are the options for configuration. Parts for CAD has a nice 3D interface that can be updated as the parts configuration is changed. Three items missing from the Parts for CAD interface important for design are pricing, availability, and technical information. Now that the part is configured, let's insert into Fusion 360. To do so, select the two Autodesk Fusion 360 button at the bottom of the preview. Unfortunately, the number of downloads from Parts for CAD is limited, and that may cause problems if you use this approach regularly. Parts for CAD provides this part as three components, and we can highlight the components by enable color cycling. The components are well named, but we can see that by expanding the browser tree. The components don't yet have joints assigned to them, but they're in position to allow us to use as-built joints. The Parts for CAD method is convenient, but it's not what I use for Misumi parts. There's information missing which is important for design decisions, namely pricing. However, for exploring ideas across many manufacturers, Parts for CAD may work well. Let's download the same part from Misumi's website. First go to Automation Components and then Linear Motion. Then select Ball Screw. The number of options can be overwhelming. On this page we have 66 options to choose from, but as we start to make selections in the configuration tool, they'll be narrowed down. Let's select a 12 millimeter screw with a 4 millimeter lead, a C7 accuracy. From 66, we quickly narrow down the two choices. And each of these choices are configurable. A strong advantage of using the Misumi website is the considerable technical information that's available for every part. Here, drawings contain labels that correspond to sections of the configuration tool. For example, L is the total length of the ball screw. In addition to these specifications, which mainly help you to understand the configuration options, there is also additional technical information available in a PDF form. Before a part can be downloaded, it needs to be fully configured. A progress bar shows you how close you are to having a single part number. There are three part numbers still matching our search. If we look at part numbers, it shows that we still need to specify at least the length. Let's set this ball screw to 150 millimeters. Now it shows that grease type is the remaining option. Selecting the standard grease type, we are now left with a single part number. With a single part number, we now have pricing and an estimated lead time. Other options can be specified, but they're not necessary in order to obtain a part that can be ordered. A complete part number fully specifies a Misumi part, including all options that don't have the default values. Part numbers can become dozens of characters in length, but this predictable approach may be useful for programmatically specifying parts. After fully specifying a part, a 3D preview is available. Updating the configuration updates the preview. Having fully specified part, we now see the pricing information and ship date. To download the part, we first log in to Misumi. And then select CAD download. Many options are available. For comparison, we'll download the step, IGES, and Inventor file formats. For step, we'll use the most recent version. For the Inventor file format, we'll use the most recent version as well. Fusion 360 has a couple of different ways to import parts. The first is to use new design from file. This does the conversion locally, but a smaller number of file formats are available. If you have one of these file formats, you may prefer this method. The second method is to use Autodesk Cloud Service. With this method, the part file is uploaded to Autodesk Cloud Service where the conversion is performed. The process takes more time, but it does have a couple of advantages. The first advantage is that you can batch a number of parts to be converted. The second advantage is once a part is converted, it inherits the name of the original file. The part that was converted using new design from file must be named when it's saved. This seems like a small step given the time difference in the two import methods, but if you're converting several part files, having the parts automatically named potentially saves a lot of time and avoids errors. Otherwise, the two methods seem to import the part identically. Another file format that we can import locally is IGES file format. It's worth looking at this file format even if we're not going to use it. The difference between the IGES import and the step import is clear when we expand the browser tree. Both formats result in three components, but with the IGES file format, each component consists of a large number of unstitched bodies. And while the unstitched surfaces can be stitched together, it's an unnecessary step when there's a file format that will import without the need to do the stitching. A small disadvantage of using the IGES file format to import Misumi parts is that the components don't have useful names. The file format that I prefer to use when importing a Misumi part into Fusion 360 is the Inventor file format. That one has to be uploaded to Autodesk Cloud Service. Inventor file format, like SOLIDWORKS format, consists of a number of files. If the files have more than one assembly, you'll need to select which is the top level assembly. I assume the reason why there's more conversion methods available on Autodesk Cloud Service is because of the licensing of those converters. Comparing the Inventor versus the step imports, you see that there's cosmetic differences between the two. Both have well-named components, but the Inventor file format also has features. Given a choice between Inventor file format and step file format, for importing Misumi parts, I prefer the Inventor file format. As a good habit and to prepare the part for use in a bill of materials, when I import a part from Misumi, I like to go into the properties and copy the part number into the description field. Given all the components are in position when we import the part from Misumi, we can use as-built joints. To use as-built joints, we first have to enable capture design history. Before we assign any joints, we'll ground one component, in this case, the ball screw. The first joint that we will assign will limit the degrees of freedom of the ball nut. First select the component that will move, then the fixed component, and then the common axis between the two components. This type of joint is a cylindrical joint. For comparison, to assign a joint to the collar, we'll use common joints instead of as-built joints. First, we need to move the collar off of the ball screw. Now capture position and select the common point between the two components. The type of motion needs to be updated to be revolute. This restricts the degrees of freedom of the collar to spin around the ball screw, but not to slide along it. Before saving the part, let's assign a material to the component so we have a reasonable estimate of mass. We now have a fully imported Misumi part that we can drag into a new assembly. We now have all the basic concepts for importing Misumi parts into Fusion 360 assemblies. There's one additional Misumi-related example I'd like to show you that I think you'll find interesting. In addition to the technical information that Misumi provides for its parts, they also have many examples of where their parts could be used. The INCAD library is a collection of examples using their parts. The examples are categorized and searchable. Let's look at positioning and clamping. The INCAD library example consists of the assembly plus a lot of information that led to the design. For someone like me who wasn't trained as a mechanical engineer, these are wonderful practical examples to learn from. Toward the bottom of the page, all the Misumi parts are listed and highlighted on the assembly. To help understand the example, the assembly can be downloaded. Fewer file formats are available for the INCAD library assemblies than are available for the parts, but we still have several choices. Unfortunately, we don't have the preferred Inventor file format, but we do have the latest STEP file format. As we saw with parts, the IGES file format will have unstitched surfaces. The SAF format is fine, but the bodies are unlabeled. The SOLIDWORKS format would seem to be a nice substitute for the unavailable Inventor file format, but my experience with importing the INCAD library assemblies in SOLIDWORKS format into Fusion 360 hasn't been great. Parts are often slightly shifted along one axis in different amounts. If I remember right, the Parasolid file format's also imported well from the INCAD library, but for consistency, I would just use the latest STEP file format. To import our INCAD library example, we'll again use Autodesk Cloud Service. The first thing that we'll do after loading the assembly is ground the base. There are many components in this assembly, and currently none of them have joints. Only the components of the lever will move, the rest of the components will be rigid. The components are arranged in sub-assemblies that allow us to select groups of components to be made into a rigid group. Now all these components are locked down. Still free to move is the lever assembly. If we look at this from the side, we can quickly select a region of components to be made into a rigid group. We'll also want this arm to pivot with the lever. To do that, we can create another rigid group. In order to allow the lever to move properly, we need to assign movable joints. To do this, we'll use as-built joints. To use as-built joints, we need to enable design history. We'll create revolute joints at four locations. First, select the first component, the second component, and then the shared axis. Repeat this for each of the joints. Now we should be able to move the lever and see the entire assembly move. We'll use this assembly in the next video, but before saving it, I like to make the component names nicer. Currently, all the component names have a suffix underscore default. We could rename each of these manually, but that would take a long time. Instead, we can rename them using a script. I've already installed the script into Fusion 360. And when I click run, watch how the component names change. The dialog that appears after the script run shows us how the names were updated. The left-hand side of the arrow shows the original name, and the right-hand side of the arrow shows the new name. Only components that were renamed are shown in this list. There's a couple improvements which would make the script nicer. The first is the prompt for the regular expression to search for, and then the replacement string. The second is to treat all of the renames as a transaction. Currently, each rename is treated as a separate operation, and that pollutes the undo history. Let's quickly look at how the script works. The script is written in Python and interacts with Fusion 360 using the Autodesk Fusion 360 API. The first part of the code is boilerplate code that you'll see in many examples, and it establishes a connection to the Fusion 360 instance. The bottom part of the code shuts that connection down. After establishing a connection to Fusion 360, the root of the assembly tree is found. Then the assembly tree is recursively traversed, with all the components being examined. And a new name is constructed for each component by substituting a replacement string for all occurrences of a regular expression. If a new name is different from the old name, then added to an accumulator is how the name was changed. Next, the component is actually renamed. Finally, the function recurses on the component, adding its return to the accumulator. Eventually, a null component is reached at the limits of the recursion, and the recursion slowly unwinds. The total accumulated message is finally returned, and a message is shown to the caller of all the renames that were performed. This script and other files can be found in the GitHub repository for this channel. The link's in the description. Until the next video, my name is Kent, and I thank you for watching.